Hi, this is Dr. Fox. Let's talk about the duodenum and the pancreas. As you recall, the duodenum is preceded by the stomach, which moves chyme into it for the processes of further digestion and absorption. The duodenum is succeeded by the jejunum, which continues the process of absorption. The duodenum is a C-shaped organ, which enjoys a very close relationship to the pancreas. Now, the duodenum consists of four parts. The first part of the duodenum is known as the superior part of the duodenum, and it's approximately 5 centimeters in length. The first 2.5 centimeters of that is going to be intraperitoneal because it is contiguous with the stomach. And it's that second part where the duodenum moves to be retroperitoneal, specifically secondarily retroperitoneal, because it is pulled behind the peritoneum during development. The first part, or the superior portion of the duodenum, is very identifiable from the remaining parts by its mucosa because it is rather smooth-walled. The remainder of the mucosa within the duodenum will have circular folds, which slow the movement of material and increase surface area for absorption. Now, the second part of the duodenum is also known as the descending part. It moves from approximately the L1 level down to the L3 level. And it's here in the second part that we'll have both the minor and the major duodenal papillae, which are going to drain the biliary tree as well as the main pancreatic duct through the major and the accessory pancreatic duct through the minor. And we'll see this in a subsequent slide. This second part has circular folds and it's secondarily retroperitoneal. The third part of the duodenum, the inferior part, is also possessing circular folds and is also secondarily retroperitoneal. It is going to move across at approximately the L3 level, and it is going to be sandwiched between, let's change the color here, it's going to be sandwiched between the SMA here and the abdominal aorta. And so if there's any sort of abdominal aortic aneurysm, this can impinge on the duodenum, and that's a condition known as superior mesenteric artery syndrome, and that can preclude the movement of materials through the small intestine. Now, that third part of the duodenum transitions into the shortest part of the duodenum, known as the ascending part. The ascending part is connected to the suspensory ligament of the duodenum, which we can't see here because it's occluded by the pancreas. That suspensory ligament of the duodenum, also known as the ligament of Treitz, is smooth muscle, which supports this duodeno-jejunal flexure. And as we move from the fourth part of the duodenum and into the jejunum, we're moving from retroperitoneal to intraperitoneal. Now let's take a look at the pancreas. Now the duodenum has been pulled away a little. We can see some of the elements of the pancreatic head, or the head of the pancreas, which is rather robust and nestled within there. There's an uncinate process that runs just posterior to the superior mesenteric vasculature. Let's just point out here is the superior mesenteric vein, and just left lateral to it is the superior mesenteric artery. So the uncinate process would be a portion of the head which kind of goes behind those vessels. The neck of the duodenum is found anterior to the SMA and SMV. That superior mesenteric vein is coming up to meet the splenic vein, and we can't see the splenic vein here, but it would be right about there. And where these two meet is the beginning of the portal vein. And the origin of the portal vein is just posterior to the neck of the pancreas. Beyond the neck is the body of the pancreas, which we can see here. And that body of the pancreas ends in the tail of the pancreas, which is nestled into the hilum here of the spleen. Now, the pancreas is, like the duodenum, predominantly a secondarily retroperitoneal structure. And the head, neck, and body are all secondarily retroperitoneal. The tail, as it's adjacent to the hilum of the spleen, which is an intraperitoneal organ, is also intraperitoneal. Let me erase some of these structures so we can take a good look at some of the ducts within. Now, the pancreas is predominantly an exocrine organ. It does have some glandular tissue which is endocrine in nature. So those pancreatic islets, or the islets of Langerhans, those are going to secrete hormones to help regulate blood glucose. But that is a small portion of the glandular tissue. Most of the glandular tissue is exocrine, and exocrine glands are going to feed into ducts, whereas endocrine glands secrete into capillaries. And what I'm outlining here is the main pancreatic duct. And we can see that this main duct is going to traverse the entirety of the pancreas there. And the glandular tissue will secrete pancreatic juice into it. And that is conducted along this duct. And it is going to meet up with the bile duct here, the common bile duct, at the pancreaticobiliary junction. And where these two meet, that's the hepatopancreatic ampulla. Hepatopancreatic ampulla. And that then will conduct the bile and the pancreatic juice through the major duodenal papilla, which we'll see in the next slide. There's also an accessory pancreatic duct, which we can see here, that may or may not connect to the main pancreatic duct. It typically does not, but it does here. That accessory pancreatic duct, when present, drains the superior portion of the head of the pancreas, and it is going to drain in the minor duodenal papilla, which we'll see now. So here is that pancreaticobiliary junction that we discussed. So here is the common bile duct coming down, and it is joining with the main pancreatic duct here. So where the two combine, we call this the hepatopancreatic ampulla. And that hepatopancreatic ampulla is going to conduct through the major duodenal papilla. So that major duodenal papilla is where the bile and the pancreatic juice are secreted into the duodenum. That is an important landmark because anything proximal to the major duodenal papilla within the GI tract up to the abdominal esophagus is foregut, and the midgut is what follows until we reach the hindgut. So the division between foregut and midgut is within the second part of the duodenum. The minor duodenal papilla, if it is present, and it is here, is in association with that accessory pancreatic duct, and it tends to be about 2.5 centimeters-ish proximal to the major duodenal papilla. And one last thing before signing off here, we can see these circular rings of duodenal mucosa, which are very representative of the second, third, and fourth parts of the duodenum, but we're looking into the second part here. So we can see these plicae circularis, or circular folds, of the mucosa here. These are the structures that slow the progress of chyme and increase surface area to maximize absorption of nutrients here in the duodenum. So we've talked about the duodenum, and it's very closely allied in location and in function pancreas. Thank you very much for your time.